My name is Frédéric Rosa. I'm a release manager at SUSE, working on the SLE product, initially SLED, the desktop product. These days also I'm helping on the server product, SLES. And today I will talk about how we manage to develop SLE and OpenSUSE Leap, OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, and make sure one distribution is not done against the other, but how we manage, or we try to manage, to develop all those distributions together. So this is a talk I've been doing. I think this is the third time I'm doing it at the OpenSUSE conference, with some statistics evolving from year to year. And I've also done this talk this year as FOSDEM, but Leap 15 was not out yet at that time, at that point in time. So now it's out. So it's interesting to see where things have improved over 1 year. So since last OpenSUSE conference. So some terminology. So this is mostly, I should have killed this slide for OpenSUSE conference. This is mostly for the FOSDEM people. So quickly, SLE, you know what it means. Same for factory, tumbleweed, and leap. Then how we develop things all together. Again, this is something which is not new to you. One funny fact, I didn't knew what Wojtek keynote was going to be about. So it's a bit like he has been talking 2 days ago on how SUSE decided at some point to bring together the SLE development with Factory. And this talk is kind of how we try to make it work. Again, briefly, for each Leap release, there is a mix of SLE core packages and then packages from Tumbleweed. And for SLE, of course, there is this mixed, this shared core and additional packages which are not available on Leap. Usually they are not available because they are not relevant for common usage distributions. They are only relevant for, I don't know, mainframe or other things like that. But in the previous Leap and SLE 12, Leap 42 and SLE 12 42 releases, we worked with the SLE 12 packages, so the core packages. We kind of retrofit packages from the previous service pack to the new one, and we pull in also packages from Tumbleweed, but with SLE 15, we started over from scratch, kind of, with Tumbleweed Factory as a basis. But let's not go too fast. First, lesson from the past, to try to not repeat the mistake from the past, but learn from them. So in SLE 12, so as I said before, I've worked initially on the desktop. So I will take the desktop as a good example, and the fact that the release manager of Tumbleweed is also part of the OpenSUSE GNOME team. He will be able to shout at me if I say something wrong. So in SLE 12, so SP0, for SLE, we picked a GNOME version, 3.10.3. And we did a lot of fixes, we did a lot of feature, and we didn't push our changes to factory. So I hear boo from the audience. You cannot hear that on the recording. And our excuse was, oh, we are too busy to work on making those features working properly without bugs, etc. we'll do the backport. We'll push back to factory later. We'll have time later. And so C12 SP0 was released. Great. And then the next version was Service Pack 1. And people were, did they push their bug fix and feature to factory? No, because they were too busy to fix bugs on Service Pack 1. So the excuse was, oh, we'll do that later. Well, we saw that it was not a good idea to keep going on with this this burden. And so we decided that for Service Pack 2, which was also so lib42.2, we will push all the changes that we did on the SLE12 GNOME to OpenSUSE, and with the ultimate goal of having the same source RPM on both distribution. And we did it. It was 300 packages to sync. There was a lot of initial discussion between the SUSE desktop teams and the OpenSUSE GNOME teams, mostly because the styles of changelog were not the same. And we, on the SUSE side, needed to learn to be part of the community. Because it's sometimes very easy when you are working on your own small thing alone, you do whatever you want and nobody or very few people will look at what you did. But when you look in the open, when you work in the open, then you have to kind of justify why you did it this way, or but no, you can do it in another way, etc. So it was really something that people had to grow with, to improve. And we create some tools to be able to check the differences between the packages on the SLE side and on the OpenSUSE side. And when there were some packages, some features which were really developed for SLE customers, we had an agreement that we would not enable those on OpenSUSE on lib, because it might change the behavior of GNOME for lib user, or it would make things worse for them. So the agreement was, if there is a patch which is kind of controversial, it will be only enabled on SLE, because it originated from SLE, and the OpenSUSE GNOME team is not feeling comfortable in having this patch enabled. Except that sometimes we also discovered that a patch that we enable on SLE, because it was not enabled on lib, people had bugs on lib that was fixed on SLE. So then we kind of, we said, for the future, we'll try to do the reverse, try to enable as much patch as possible. Of course, upstream them whenever it's possible also, but still use only enable patch on one distro or the other as this solution as last resort. So to summarize, we worked internally and we had a devil project on our internal bit service, and then we were pushing things to OpenSUSE. We had to do a lot of work also on change logs, because something which is very important for SUSE customer is to make sure that we don't regress from one service pack to another, from one release to another. They want to be sure that all the bug fixes are in, all the security fixes are in, etc. And one way we use to track that is we put in changelog fate number, bug number, CV number, which is for most of you as OpenSUSE user not that useful, but for the soothe people. It's very useful, and we tracked this way how to make sure that a bug is still fixed when we update the version of a package. So to make this tracking easy, we made sure that when we retrofit all the changes from SLI to OpenSUSE, sometimes we inserted some dummy changelog entry to make sure that, yes, this bug, even if it's a new version of a package, this bug is still fixed. So we could see, okay, somebody has checked that this bug is still fixed, even if the package is removed. And thanks to OpenSUSE people at large to accepting this kind of dummy changelog entry thing, because it helped a lot to have same packages between SLI and OpenSUSE. And also, because of the way LIP is created, we made sure that the SLI people are have to handle the bug which are reported against LIP for packages which are originating from SLI. And sometimes it's easy, sometimes it's less easy, because when you get a bug report for a package, whatever, in GNOME or whenever else, which is coming from the community, and somebody at SUSE has to take care of it, but it's not coming from a customer, a paying customer, and he has a lot of other duties, it can be a bit tricky to make sure that things are processed quickly. But we are trying. So that was the past. SLI 12, LIP 42. Now, going to SLI 15, LIP 15, because this is where the action I was going to say is, but now I should say was. LIP 15 is out. So let's see how we accept things in SLI, because this way you will better understand. So if you are working at SUSE, you will better understand sometimes why we reject things. And if you are not working at SUSE, you will understand how some people are, might be not always happy with when we say factory first. And yeah, my drawing is not that great. After seeing Jim's beautiful chart, but yes, it's as fuzzy as it can be. So the way, and for people who are used to OBS, it's kind of similar to what Factory is doing, but it's still a good exercise to better understand how things are done. When people want to change something on the distribution, being on SLI, being on Factory. So first you create your changes in your, in a branch, in your home directory, in your own project. You will create a submit request, and this submit request will land in, for a specific distribution, being OpenSUSE Factory, being SLI 15, for instance. Then a staging manager, so either a bot or a human, it depends, will put that that submit request into a staging, what we call a staging project, which is going to generate either a small ISO image, or it's going to rebuild the packages, and all the packages which would be rebuilt if these packages was injected in the distribution. So, for instance, you push a new Qt 5, it would try to rebuild on Factory, it would try to rebuild KDE and make sure that KDE can be rebuilt. So it's going to, the OBS or the IBS is going to rebuild a small subset of the distribution, and OpenQA will then run a set of tests on this small distribution, except it will not run the full test suite, because the full test suite is huge. It takes a long time. There, it's a selected set of tests, usually kind of a minimal install test, a default install, some consistency check, secure boot install, and maybe a creep setup install, I'm not sure, but something around that. And it's going to, you will see on the dashboard, does it install properly, does all the tests are green or not, and then it sits and wait. In parallel, there will be a lot of bots checking the submit request. I will go on that later. And also some humans. So there it's mandatory for SLI and also for factory to have two sets of two eyes. So basically two humans, so four eyes, who are going to check the submit request and see if it's following the rules, if it's not completely crazy, if it's written properly, if there is no backdoor inserted in a patch, for instance, it could happen, etc. If sometimes, if the submit request looks good, but then one of the reviewers knows that yes, but if we take that, it's going to break something else because of the experience of the reviewer. It can happen. So, if everybody is in agreement, we'll get, and if OpenQA is green, we'll accept this submit request, and then it will be committed to the distribution itself, so factory on one side or SLI on the other side. Then the entire distro will be rebuilt. ISO image will be generated, repository will be generated, and when everything is done, OpenQA will run again on the entire distro and we'll see if it's suitable or not for release. And then at the on the SLI side, it's a human which is going to decide, yes, we will release that or not. On factory, are you manually reviewing the test or if it's two test manager? Okay, so just to repeat, on factory side, there is a bot which is doing some checks, and if it's not 100% sure, it's going to say, I need to ask my master, who is then going to press a button. So, you know the process now, but as mentioned in the beginning of my talk and also by Wojtek during his keynote, we wanted to be sure that all the development done on the SLI side is always, or most of the time, contributed back to factory. Why doing that? We could say we want to be good contributors. We are members of OpenSUSE, so we want to make sure OpenSUSE is stay great, OpenSUSE Factory. But you can also see that by being more selfish, which is also a good argument. We want to make sure that our next major product, major release, will be ready and stable as our previous one. So we want to make sure that when we release the next major version of SLI, so now it will be SLI 16, not 15, but 16, we can take OpenSUSE Tumbleweed and then work on it, but we'll know that all the development which was done during SLI 15 will be in OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, which was not what we were doing in the past always. As I gave the example of the GNOME thing, so GNOME was a small subset, but just also the development of Li-12 initially was very painful, as Wojtek explained already. The entire company spent, I don't know, a year just to take factory and make it acceptable by enterprise standards. And we didn't want to have this pain again. So we have put in effect a policy internally at SUSE, which is called Factory First. Maybe we should have renamed it Tumbleweed First, but still, it's still good. So it's in effect since Li-12 SP3. And it's also in effect for Li-15. So what we ask people at SUSE is, when they can, they should do their development directly on OBS. And then push back their development to Li-15. So, which means, in best and easiest scenario, you do your changes, you do your either a package update or bug fix on a package, whatever, or new code added to package for a new feature. Either you can get it accepted upstream, which is the best way, but sometimes you are not able to get it upstream, or you cannot wait until upstream reads a new version. So you push it to the distribution, but the way we ask people to do it is push it to factory. Don't try to push it directly to Li-15. Push it to factory. It will be reviewed by the factory people. It will be reviewed first by the developer, by the maintainer of the development project, then by the factory reviewer. And when it's accepted in factory, then we'll take it in Li-15. And to make that even easier for them, we put in place some bots which were automatically, when there was a new package change in factory, which was already in Li-15, it was, and when some change were checked in factory, it was creating automatically a submit request to Li-15. So for people, it was like, okay, I develop on factory, it's accepted, and then it's automatically, I don't even have as a developer to do any work, it's going to be pushed automatically to Li-15. So it doesn't have, at least it's reduced the burden, the friction of this policy. This way, we smoothed a lot the development between factory and Li-15. And this was in place, so this automatic forward of packages, which it was done until RC1 or RC2 of Li-15. And then we disabled the bot, which was submitting automatically. And we asked people, now you can please cherry pick if you really want to push something to factory. For factory, you should still push things, but it won't be automatically forwarded from factory to Li-15. And when people were submitting directly internally to Li-15, the reviewer were checking, is there something which is exactly the same on the OBS side? And based on all of this, the release manager, so myself, Rado, Stefan Bellet, Antoine Gignes, and all the others, Alex also, decided should it go in or not. And also, thanks to that, we made sure that Li-15 development was always live on OBS. So starting with the beta phase, Li-15 was available on OBS. You could see things moving, and it allowed Li-15 to be developed also in the open, which is normal for OpenSUSE Lib, but it was live when we started the beta phase of Li-15. So basically, in short words, what is the factory first policy? Your submit request will not pass unless a lot of bots run on it and say it can pass. Those bots are legal bots, So it's going to check against the legal DB if the license is acceptable or if it's, the legal analysis is similar to previous submit requests which were accepted in the past. Then there is a maintenance bot, which is checking that the package build in the development, in the developer project. Funnily enough, we got some mission where the packages was not even building on the home project of the developer. We have the changelog checker. So honestly, each submission must have a bug number or a feature number or a CV number in the changelog, with the caveat or the exception is we also accept if the change has already been accepted on factory. So this is also to basically, we don't want people to create bug dummy bug number just because they need to submit something on SLI. If the same change has been accepted on factory, then we consider that it's acceptable on SLI regarding changelog. So because otherwise it would force people to create dummy bugs on factory changelog just to get them in SLI. So which is kind of stupid. I forgot a bot in this list because we added it recently. It's a factory bot, which kind of check if patches are properly applied, listed, and a few other checks. And another bot was also added. We added tons of bots since last February. We also add a repo checker bot, which checks that basically the packages can be installed, because funnily, also we get submission with packages which cannot be installed at all on the distribution. And then there is the Leaper bot. Ah, the Leaper bot. I think a lot of people in SUSE rant about this bot, because this bot is checking if a submission done on SLI is following basically factory first policy. Which means if the packages had been submitted directly from factory, okay, fine, nothing to check, it's okay. And we have a bot which is kind of doing those submission. But if the packages came initially from factory, the bot will check if the same change are in factory, or if they have been submitted to factory, not yet accepted, but are on the develop project of the on OBS. And if it's not, the submission is rejected directly without a human intervention. And sometimes there are some exceptions to that. There are some packages where we say, okay, for those packages, we are not following factory anymore because of choices. Like, for instance, for the kernel, we don't have the factory kernel. We have a SLI 15 kernel. So there the bot is being, we told the bot, okay, for those, don't check against factory. Or at least check against factory, but if the same submission is not on factory, don't reject. Just had a comment to say, this submission is not in factory, and that's it. What's the outcome of those bots? We discovered that it's good to use bots because, and it's good to automate things, because people are much less emotional if their submission is rejected by a bot rather than a human. With a human, they will argue. With a bot, some will argue. but a lot will fix their submission immediately. We also have the, initially the bot for the changelog was also, and it's also now in auto-reject mode, and it's extremely efficient. When you do your submission, it's rejected in the one minute later by the bot telling you you forgot to put a bug number. You can see there is a new submission 2 minutes later with a bug number. So, people, of course, they are pissed or frustrated because they got their submission rejected, but they are way, at least that's our impression, they are way less frustrated when it's coming from a bot, because it's like, yeah, the bot set the rule, it's a dummy bot, I'm not going to argue with it, with exception. And we also learn that if the bot can be verbose enough to give explanation on why it rejected the thing, it helped. People were made aware of why it was rejected, because this submission is not identical on the OBS side. There is a diff, click there to see the diff, and then people can see that, oh yes. Sometimes people are spending time to do exactly the same thing on the internal build service, on the external build service, basically writing the changelog 2 times, and the submission was rejected because the timestamp was different. There was 30 seconds of difference on the timestamps, which shows that they did the work twice, which is awful for them because they have the feeling that they are doing the work twice, which is true. And it can be automated, and there is a bot which is basically telling them, yeah, you don't have to do your work twice. So as much as possible, use bot and automation for reviews. It saves people time, because also when things are rejected early, they can be fixed early, and you don't have to wait until a human sees that, oh, your submission is not acceptable because you forgot this or this. Of course, it's also good to have a way to override the tool, because it's a bot, it's a dummy bot, so sometimes the bot is stupid, so you have a way to tell it. No, I'm the staging manager, I'm the release manager, you are going to do what I tell you, and you are going to accept this submission. We have to make sure that every contributor have tools at their disposal so that can learn and don't do work 2 times, 3 times, 4 times. So, as I said, sometimes a bot will say, you should not pass, and we convince him that, yes, the submission will pass. So, it's good that we talked about the factory first policy. But what are its effects on the development? So this is the number of original packages. So it's not the total number of packages, but the packages which changed in each service pack since SLE 12 service pack 1, and where those packages were coming from. So in SLE 12 SP1, compared to SLE 12, we changed around 500 packages. And factory first was not in place, so every change were considered a fork compared to factory. In SLE 12 SP2, it was a refresh release, so we basically changed 1,000 packages compared to SLE 12 SP1. And all of them were not coming from factory, because again, factory first was not in place. In SP3, we started to put in place factory first. Then we had kind of 500 packages changed compared to SP2, and 28%, were coming from factory, which means that about one third of the contribution of the work done by the SUSE people on SP3 was pushed to factory, which is not bad. Then came SLE15. So SLE15, there's a bit more packages changed because everything changed, of course. So it's 3,800 packages. I have the details number after, but it's on the screen. It's better to have a chart. As you can see, the factory part is a bit higher compared to SP3. So the exact number is 8.4% packages are forked, which are different from factory, which means SLE15, when I checked the number last week, we are almost done with SLE15 development. 91.6% of the packages, I'm speaking in terms of package number, not line of code, but package number, 91.6% of the source packages are identical to factory/tumbleweed. That's not bad. We cannot expect 100%. There are things which are different and on purpose. SLE15 is shipping with kernel 4.12. Factory is not. Tumbleweed is not. SLE15 is shipping with glibc, which is a bit older than the glibc in factory, etc. So 100%, it's not possible. And it's not possible simply because Tumbleweed is always rolling. So unless something is broken somewhere, but so the divergence will always be increasing over time. But when I did the statistics last Thursday, we were at 91.6%. This is kind of good for the factory first policy. Now LEAP. Because we are on open source conference, it's not SUSE conference, it's not SUSECon. So on LEAP, I did the same statistics. So LEAP 42.1 is a bit special. It was the first LEAP release. So you could see that a few packages were coming from SLE. So those are the dark green. And most of the packages were coming from factory, which was kind of expected. LEAP was done with a SLE core and a lot of fresh packages on top. Then 42.2 and 42.3, there is a green, a new flavor of green on top. You can see it's basically the packages which are reused from the previous LEAP release. So there you can see that I think one third of the packages got refreshed. And then the rest was either coming from SLE or from a previous LEAP release. And the 15, so there is a bit more packages coming from SLE 15. And the rest is factory. When on this slide I say is factory, it's packages which are not shipped at all on SLE, like KDE and tons of other packages, KDE, LXDE, you name it. So if I would put, maybe I should have done that, maybe I will improve my graph for the next time. The SLE section, I should have put the factory part of the SLE in it. So I think we would have seen a very small percent of packages which are SLE specific and majority of packaging coming from factory. So yeah, so the raw number, 11,600 source packages from LEAP GM, 25% coming from SLEE15. And on those 25%, 91% coming from factory. And 8,600 packages coming from factory. And 20 packages coming from other repo. So that's it for my talk. But I welcome your question and your feedback, because as we discovered, nothing is set in stone. We welcome feedback. We all try to improve our process. We try to improve our policies. And we want to make things as smooth as possible. Questions? Andrew, behind you.
Why are the 20 packages from Devel projects?
It's mostly KD thing. Because, Dominic?
Yeah, so that's mostly packages that moved ahead in version in factory already, before lib was frozen. SLEE didn't have them, but they still needed fixes.
So it's kind of an artifact of, again, factory being so fast that some those distribution which are slower or more stable than factory, of course, we have to take some measure to where the packages are coming from. Other questions, comments? Yes, one over there. The microphone is coming. Thank you, Wolfgang.
I don't have any experience yet with packaging for SLEE 15 or Deep 15, but in the past when you package a new package for then a lot of libraries were missing for SLEE.
Okay. Yep.
Is this all for SLEE 15 or what
so
has been
we,
done about
we
it?
Tried to check if development project on OBS were building properly on with SLEE 15. Not 100% of them are, but thanks to on the other side, on one side we have package up to try to provide additional packages, and we check that, for instance, LibreOffice on OBS is able to be rebuilt fully on SLEE 15, but with only the packages from OBS, from SLEE 15, sorry. Same for the GNOME version we ship on SLEE. There is a GNOME stable 3.26 project on OBS, which have all the packages needed to be rebuilt on SLEE 15. So we cannot put everything, but we try to put as much as possible. And I have time for one more question, but that will be the last. And after, the board will kick me out of stage. Yes.
Yeah, might be a dumb question, but I did not correctly understand if this is only for SLEE Core or if this is also for the process for the modules like PHP and so on.
So this is for everything which was submitted to the SUSE SLEE 15 GA project, which included packages like PHP and stuff like that.
Thank you.
And we try also to have this process in place for maintenance update, because sometimes we have things which are being pushed through maintenance update, and we want to make sure they are also made available on factory. And with that, I want to thank you, and we are going to get board on stage. Thank you.